and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Juggernaut, and I have news. Well, most of what I'm initially going to say about this, you've probably already heard if you're really into Warhammer Total War and Total War games in general, but I do have some information that you may not be aware of. So, I guess, welcome to the video, and enjoy your stay. So, let us begin by addressing the elephant in the room. As we are all well aware of by this point, the next expansion, well, it's not really an expansion, but Warhammer Total War 2 is going to be released relatively soon. I say relatively soon, it's not like, it's not soon, but you know, relatively is, I guess maybe putting it a little bit generous, but I'm getting distracted. It is going to be released, let's just say, relatively soon, and I can't wait for it. There are a few issues, though, but a few things that extremely excite me, and I want to talk to you about them first. So, elephant in the room is as follows. Warhammer Total War, the one you're seeing gameplay footage of right now, and Warhammer 2 will merge into one game. They're saying several weeks after the release of Warhammer 2. Under a month, but 2 to 3 weeks. I think it might be even sooner if everything goes as planned. But I think they're leaving a lot of room there for, I guess, technical problems and, you know, stuff to deal with and so on and so forth. I think they're being a bit generous with their timeline and their schedules. But you know what? Within 2 to 3 weeks, let's say, is the most pessimistic of what can happen. The two games will merge into one, unlocking the entire map in the Grand Campaign map mode. This means that you will be able to play on this map, plus the Lizardmen Kingdoms and all the other sort of surrounding areas that they're going to add. If you remember, years and years ago, in one of the first interviews for Warhammer Total War 2, I believe Total Biscuit talked about this, and as well as Angry Joe, and I believe this is where I got this information from, again, it was a long, long time ago. This was the initial plan for this game. So this is not something that Creative Assembly and the developers behind Warhammer 2 just decided to do on a whim. I believe this is information that we were given years ago, but people have sort of forgotten about it, right? Forgotten that Warhammer Total War is not going to just remain this with a few DLC factions, but they're going to expand the map as you buy what at the time was phrased in such a way that we thought was DLC, but we're actually now discovering were our standalone games, and I believe they never actually specifically said whether they're going to be full-on standalone games, whether they're going to be expansions, be it massive expansions or however. It was never that precisely said. At least I don't remember. Maybe it was. But again, I don't precisely remember. However, be that as it may, it's happening. Took a while, but it is happening. So, what can we expect? You know, it's obvious they're going to expand the entire map, but what can we expect actually in terms of the features? And does it justify the price tag? And stuff like that is a little bit of a touchy subject, and I'll get into that in a bit. But for now, I wanted to tell you that I've talked with the developers. Yes, I have. And I may or may not have information that I am that I may or may not be allowed to disclose. So, we're all adults here. I think you'll understand what I mean, right? But I have discussed, or the devs have discussed this on Facebook a little bit. Or, not the devs, but you know, the official PR team or whatever. They have revealed some information about this on Facebook and on Twitter, I believe, as well. So we do know a little bit of what's going on. Obviously, full details of all this are still to come, as you know, the game isn't even made yet, so there's that tiny little problem. But regardless of the fact, we now have a massive Total War game to look forward to. So the obvious question is, what about the price tag? Well, you're buying two separate games. Essentially, that will merge into one. Do I justify that? There is some really bizarre notion out there going on the social media websites on the internet now that unless they make a new engine, that they shouldn't charge $60 for this, which... No, I'm pretty sure that's not how it works. It doesn't make any sense. Hell, a new engine would be nice, but then also merging the two would be impossible, so I'm not quite sure you know what you're asking for. So I certainly don't think that's the case, that if they don't make a new engine for the game, that they shouldn't charge $60 for it, or shouldn't charge full price for it. However, it does put you in a bit of a weird spot, because it gives you the other half of the, the other half of the grand map when the two are merged, for the price of the full initial game's release. However, I'm going to defend Creative Assembly here a little bit and their expansion practices, which I can't believe I'm saying, but I believe it is right to do so. If you compare the amount of content released day one for this game and the amount of content released day one for the other game, for Warhammer 2, you'll find that they're more or less the same, right? Sure, the map size might be a little bit different, but that doesn't make up for much, right? It does, but it's not that big of a difference. Can I not?
Let's take what should be ours.
Oh, that's because I didn't need this. There we go. I need them all updated, I'm just... Yeah, there we go. I'm sorry about that, getting distracted. So, I do justify the full price tag, simply if we're comparing the amount of content for both games separately. Furthermore, however, what about people look at it like, well, it's basically one game cut into two. No, it's two games cut into one, right? Cut in doesn't make sense, but you get the point, right? It's not simply one game, and then they sold it as two different bits, although some developers do tend to do that occasionally. Not to point any fingers, of course. However, this is simply not the case. So, what about the total price of everything? If that makes sense, right? And by that I mean, what about the total price of not just the two games separately, but the two separate games joined together, which was basically the price of two... They're just two full-price games, right? Not just that, but what about the... what about all the DLC for both of them? And here again, believe it or not, I'm going to jump to the defense of EA. Right. Again, for and against EA, we're in a discussion that has nothing to do with EA to begin with. There is an inside joke to be made there, but at any rate, I'm going to jump to the defense of Creative Assembly here. Reason being rather simple. I believe they're right to have this much DLC, and to have the pricing be where it is right now. I believe it is fair. Now, say what you will on the matter, but I'm used to playing, for a large part of my strategy games library, shall we say, is Paradox Grand strategy games. And those games are infamous for their DLC. Now, in fact, if you were going to pick up something like Crusader Kings 2, which is a game that's been out for a while now, quite a while, actually, you'll find out that all of the DLC combined costs, a lot, right? We're talking around $200 worth of DLC. It depends. Sometimes you can get it on sale, so on and so forth, but it is an extraordinary amount of money for DLC. And yet, it's worth it, one, and it's fair, simply due to the amount of content added and the amount of content you have acquired. I believe it is perfectly fair for CK2, EU4, Stellaris. Well, Stellaris we're still early on, but getting there too. EU3 and all that to cost as much as it does. Again, because of the amount of content that you acquire through paying all that money that is asked of you on talking about the base price, of course, and without any sales or anything. Same is going, at least the similar thing is going on over here. This is not just some ploy to steal more money from you, this is actual content. You get a full second game with as much content, or relatively as much content, as the first one. So there is, I really don't believe there's anyone's greed here at play. Furthermore, you got to remember that Creative Assembly needs to make money off of this, right? And developers need to eat and get paid. And this is not just breaking even, they need to make enough money to make Warhammer Total War 3. The hell did that come from? Well, don't hold me to this, but... And I'll say but one more time. But. Now, I'm not trying to be funny. I'm struggling. I'm grasping for a straw here. Here's the thing. We were promised... Maybe a bit of a harsh word, but... We're expected, shall we say, or we expected previously, to receive three of these games. Or three of these expansions, what we regarded as expansions at the time, you know. You know what I mean, right? We expected three of these. Warhammer, logically, that would be Warhammer 1, Warhammer 2, and Warhammer 3, Total War, eventually covering the entire map with all three games, and probably, like, various DLC in between, like, you know, Britonia is actually free, which, by the way, shout out for that. But, you know, like Wood Elves, Beastmen, so on and so forth, like that DLC, smaller DLC bits cut in between. We expected that with those three expansions, which we're now discovering are fully fledged independent games, to receive the full Warhammer map. And that's, I believe, what we're basically going to get in due time, obviously, because... they're going to make two, then they're going to make probably some DLC for Warhammer 2, merge that in with Warhammer Total War, the one we're playing right now, and yeah, you get where this is going, yeah? But I do believe that this practice is fair. It's a lot of money, but it's a lot of stuff as well. Think of it like this. If Attila Total War... and Rome Total War 2 merged into one game, and you were able to play as Rome in the Punic Wars, right? Or it began around the era of the Second Punic War, right? That's where the Grammar Campaign begins? Or is it the first one? When did that actually begin? What year does Rome 2 begin in? Jesus Christ, I'm sorry. I knew this off the top of my head, but my brain is frozen at the moment, apparently. Something for words as well. So yeah, if those two games merged into one, so to speak, where you were able to play for a much longer historical time period, you wouldn't call that theft, would you? If you had to pay $120 for that, or again the price of two full games, because it is two entirely separate games that we have right now. Just imagine them merging into one for a longer time in history, and maybe expanding the map a little bit. Or, better yet, think of this as... Crusader Kings 2 did this again, and they keep reminding me of Paradox bit by bit, and that's a good thing, believe me, that's a very good thing. The more Creative Assembly looks like Paradox, the better the community will be off, trust me on this. As someone that has a very long history with Paradox, in the most positive meaning of that word. That phrase, I beg your pardon, but, at any rate, back to my original point. Crusader Kings 2 did something like this. So imagine if in... Let's use Medieval 2 Total War as an example. You paid $60, or, again, the price of the full game on release itself, to get the map of India into the game. And you could play... just India alone, and you know, as the Rajas of India. You could play as the various kingdoms over there and conquer India, and that's good, but if you pay for both games, they merge together and you have one grand campaign map. This is basically it. Now, The people then begin to question whether there is enough content in Warhammer 2 to justify its price. So, okay, paying for both together to make it one big game, paying out two separate ones, make them one bigger game, that's fair enough, and especially because it's free, right? Why the hell not? Does it have enough content to justify? Well, I believe it does. Lustria is a very, well, a very swampy territory, that's true. But it's also a pretty big territory, it's pretty big, right? Now, I don't think we're going to see naval combat, which is unfortunate, though I have yet to confirm that. I don't know. I've seen a few weeks ago, I think, news that there won't be naval combat. I have to confirm that right now, so again, don't trust me on that. But I don't think there'll be naval combat the way things are right now. So that's a little bit unfortunate, and certainly I would understand people asking for more content in that direction and in that sense, but I do believe that just Lustria on its own, with Lizardmen Kingdoms and the High Elves and all the other factions that were announced, is more than enough to justify the price of the full game. Again, comparing it to the amount of content that was released for this game initially, and the amount of stuff you get for $60 in this game. Ah. A bit of water. I'm still here. So yes, what else? What else is there? See, here's the thing. When we get these two games merged up together in a bundle, all nice and tight, I fully expect, and I'll be disappointed if this is not the case, to receive a few more bits of free LC. Well, that's what CA have decided to call it, so I like the name, to be honest. What is free LC? Well, free DLC that doesn't involve them making a fuck ton of new content, just basically adding a few things to the game, much like they added Bretonnia. Which, again, the fact that Bretonnia is free really amazes me, and I'm very thankful for that. But something like that to the game. For example, again, if I'm right about the naval combat thing, a free DLC for naval combat would be a bit much. I think that is something I would be willing to pay for, simply because it's an entire new aspect of battle. You have to design ships, right? You start from scratch. So that would make sense to pay a hefty price, I guess, for that. That would make sense, but as far as everything else is concerned, like a few other factions, a few other, maybe a few other unit packs or something, to get that as free LC, I would, I certainly expect, and I don't know, maybe I'm being, yeah, some people will call me naive, but I do think that is something that is relatively likely to happen. Again, apparently my favorite word of the day. But at any rate, we now know a lot more about the future of this game and how it's going to hold up. And it is exciting. It is very exciting to hear that we're not going to be just receiving the Skaven as, you know, DLC with a little bit of map, and then for another $20 we'll receive maybe the two Tomb Kings with a little bit of map, and then that it's all going to be bundled up into one, and then possibly, or I'll venture to say probably, another game later down the line. So yeah, I'm really curious as to what you think, because ultimately it is three separate games. I believe the amount of content in each of those does justify the game's prices themselves. What I will, however, I guess criticize very vocally Creative Assembly on is the varying DLC prices. I may defend them for placing a $60 base, basically essentially making a $60 big expansion and then selling it to us, but what I will never defend is the Chaos Warriors or the Wood Elves or something like that costing $20 in one region, $10 in another, and $15 in a third region. That, to me, is a bit weird, and I guess it does raise a little bit of a problem with all these DLCs as well. Obviously, their very nature is not quite mandatory, and I believe they almost encourage this entire pick it up when it's on sale type of attitude due to the nature of their content. However, what I do find a little bit off-putting, shall we say, is now we have $20 worth of, I don't know, it's the Wood Elves or, you know, any of those types of DLCs, the Beastmen, for example, as well, any of those types of DLCs mentioned. And now we're going to receive, for 60, we're going to receive an entirely new map, basically, almost double the size of this one, for 60, so for like three DLCs in the base game, which would be what? Wood Elves, Beastmen, Chaos Warriors, although the Chaos Warriors pack was cheaper, but, you know, somewhere in there, depending on which region you are in, obviously, of course. You get that. So that's a bit off-putting, and to the consumers, certainly, I guess it could be a bit, troubling, let's say. But, at any rate, I don't think it really presents a huge problem at all. It is expensive, though. It doesn't change the fact. It might be justified, but it still is very expensive, and, I guess that brings me to my next. It's a good segue for the next topic of the conversation. That's the player base. Considering this is not a multiplayer title, or, you know, it's a title with multiplayer, but it's not a multiplayer-driven title, it's not that big of an issue, but you have to consider that as well. How many people are willing to pay the full price for this game? Or for these games? Presumably there will be three of them, but yeah, whatever. Two or three games. It is a lot of money. Now, don't get me wrong, there are, myself included in this bunch, there are a lot of hardcore, dedicated Warhammer fans that play these games tons on a daily basis. And almost certainly we will, at one point or another, pick up all three of these games and enjoy a humongous campaign map in the Warhammer universe. Obviously, I guess if I already mentioned myself, then personally I can't do this just yet because, you know, I have school, but I have university to attend to, and I have some other priorities at this stage, but that's completely irrelevant at this stage, of course. But you know what I mean, like, eventually we will pick this up and it will be worth it for us. What about the average user, though? Someone that is not so much into this type of game, and, well, for them I can see how that could be off-putting. But, at any rate, I do believe it is justified, and I am excited for the expansion and all of the things that it entails with it, and see how it will develop in the future. Obviously, again, this is pretty much based on mostly speculation, because a lot of information hasn't been released yet, and we'll see, obviously, how things develop, and we're not entirely sure on the exact amount of content that will be in Warhammer 2, so it's a bit early to speculate maybe on whether the pricing is fair and all of that, or whether Warhammer 2 costing a full $60 would be fair or not. It's not. It's a bit early to speculate, like I already said, but at any rate, until we get some more news, that's pretty much all we can do, so whatever. See anything necessarily wrong with that either, so long as we understand what all the speculation entails and keep reasonable expectations. But at any rate, I believe that's more or less everything in terms of the news that I am allowed to disclose at this time. So just give me a second here. So, yeah, I am excited. At this point in my life, I'm also piss poor and probably don't have enough money to buy everything for this glorious game, but I'm excited nonetheless. Tell me what you think, though. I am genuinely curious as to see what my viewers make of this entire situation that's arisen here, because it's kind of what we expected, but perhaps a little bit different as well. So, yeah, I guess we shall see ultimately, shan't we? Is there anything else I wanted to talk about? I'm thinking here for a moment. Oh, yeah, just a tiny little thing. No pre-order bonuses for Warhammer 2 thus far. Or, no, sorry, that's not fair. No pre-order locked content that should be in the game for Warhammer 2 at the point of making this video. I think after the entire Chaos Warriors DLC, they've learned from their mistakes. Or I hope they did. No, on a more serious note, though, none of the factions that I know of will be locked. Or that we know of will be locked behind a pre-order paywall, or a pre-order wall of some sort. So, obviously, fantastic news for the children and the people of the land. Seriously, though, that's great. That's great. Thank you very much. Now you're being reasonable. Great. If it stays like that, good. If you change something, we're gonna have a few words, you and I. But might make an angry rant video about that. Say, I don't know, lock the Skaven behind pre-order or something. That would be very scummy. But yeah, I don't mind cosmetic bonuses for pre-orders and stuff like that. Obviously, I should point that out right now. Or, you know, anything along those lines. I really don't care. But if it's a core feature of the game, like a faction or something, yeah, then yeah, yes, I mind, obviously. but at any rate, none of that, so far at least. So, great news, obviously. Yeah, is that everything? But I think that's everything for now. So, not very much on the news front, but I did give you perhaps some information that you were not aware of, and my impressions as well, and my thoughts on the entire situation too. So, obviously there is some stuff I'm not allowed to disclose, but yeah. Worry not about that, it's nothing major. So, there we go. Thank you very much for watching, ladies and gentlemen. Please remember to like and subscribe down below if you enjoyed this video, and stay tuned with the rest of the content that I produce on the channel. Till next time, take care, have fun, and bye-bye.